to introduce Dr. Stephen Kane. He's faculty at San Francisco State University. An Australian, Dr. Kane received his BS in physics from Macquarie University. He then spent 3 years at Space Telescope Science Institute as part of his PhD, which he received through the University of Tasmania. Before joining San Francisco State University, Dr. Kane spent time as a research fellow at the University of St. Andrews in Scotland. He was at the University of Florida, and most recently he was at NASA Exoplanet Science Institute at Caltech. Dr. Kane is a leading expert in planetary habitability and has discovered or co-discovered several hundred planets orbiting other stars. It is my great pleasure to welcome Dr. Stephen Kane.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Scott, for that introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's my first time coming to this campus. It's a beautiful campus. I had some time to look around before coming to give this talk. So what I'm going to be doing today is giving you some highlights of what's going on in this field of looking for planets and trying to assess their habitability. And this is not an easy question to answer about whether there is life out there and whether there are habitable planets, but it's a very unique time in history in which we now live, because we are moving from the realm of having to be armchair philosophers, which is what people have had to have been for thousands of years in addressing this question, to a point where we can actually quantify the answers to it. So it's pretty exciting what's going on, and I'm going to be highlighting some of the results, but also showing you some of the caveats, some things that you should think about when you hear some of these results, when you think about what makes a planet habitable, which is a very interesting question on its own to just ponder for a while about what it is that makes the Earth habitable, and trying to escape from this anthropic viewpoint that we inevitably have when answering this question. So let's get started. I've been doing this for more than 20 years. As Scott mentioned, I started my grad school work in the mid-90s. And at that point, the whole field of exoplanets was really starting to rapidly expand. And it was a very fortunate time for me to start doing this work because of that. And as time has gone on and I've been able to work at these various places and I've had the opportunity to use different methods for finding these planets. And now what I tend to do is I divide my research, it's become so diverse, I tend to divide it into three main areas. The first area, and perhaps the most important, is detection. After all, without detection, we are still armchair philosophers. So detection is something I've been doing for the past 20 years. I started out using something called microlensing, which I'm not going to talk about here today. But since then, I've started using the radial velocity method, transit method, various methods, and I'm going to explain some of those briefly to you. Now that we have a bunch of planets to talk about, we can start talking about characterizing these planets. And so this is the second part of my research, which is talking about things like the atmospheres of these planets, their orbits, their eccentricities. There's all kinds of finer details that we can start to look at for these planets, to investigate planetary science in a broader context. And thirdly, habitability, which is, of course, one of the areas where a lot of people are very interested in, we're trying to head towards. And habitability, like I mentioned earlier, has a lot of facets to it. And you can get lost in all the kinds of things which can make a planet habitable. But this is part of my research as well. And I'm going to be talking about things like the Habitable Zone and what is the Habitable Zone during this talk. So you could think of the overlap of all three areas in this Venn diagram right in the middle there as the detection characterization of habitable worlds, which is what we're really trying to do. So first of all, I want to talk a little bit about how we discover these planets, because there's a real problem with trying to see planets, see them directly because you have a very faint object next to a very bright object, which is the star it's orbiting. The angular separation between those two is usually going to be much, much less than your ability to resolve that with whatever instrument that you're using. So if we can't see the planets directly, what can we do? Well, we can find the planets indirectly, which means that we can't see the planet itself, but we can see the effect the planet has on its surroundings, and most particularly the star it's orbiting. And the reason that's a good thing to look at is because we can see the star. We can measure the star very well. And so if the planet is having an effect on the star, then we can detect the presence of the planet. And there's two main ways in which we do that. The first one, the animation shown at the top, is something we call the Doppler wobble method, or the radial velocity method. It has a variety of names, but essentially it's a gravitational effect. And the effect is caused by the planet and the star orbiting a center of mass. So when we think about the moon, for example, we often think about, the moon orbits the Earth, right? Except it doesn't. The moon and the Earth both go around a common center of mass, which means that the moon is making the Earth wobble as it's going around from this common center of mass. And the same thing is true when we have a planet orbiting a star. The planet makes a star wobble, and that's something that we can measure. Yeah. And we've been doing that for the past 20 years. And the bottom animation is showing a different method, which we call the transit method. And the transit method has become, and I'll show you why in a moment, the dominant way of discovering planets. And it's great because the transit method is telling you the size of the planet. The reason is because if the planet passes in front of the star from our line of sight, then it blocks out some of the light. How much light it blocks out depends upon the area of the disk, which is crossing the star, and so it tells you about the radius of the planet. Since the top one is a gravitational effect, it tells you about the mass. The bottom one is telling you the radius. You put those two together, you can get a mean density from the planet and do all kinds of planetary science with that. But there's some other tricks that we can play with transit planets, which I'll talk about in a moment. So the transit method and the radial velocity method have given us overwhelmingly most of the planets that we now know about. But the transit method requires that you be able to precisely measure the brightness of the star for long periods of time. That means you want to, first of all, you want to remove the Earth's atmosphere. Astronomers have for a long time wanted to remove the Earth's atmosphere, which is why they shouldn't be in charge of too much. But they've wanted to remove it because the atmosphere is what is making stars twinkle. And that's a beautiful thing and makes for beautiful poetry and so on, but it ruins our measurements. And what we'd like to do is be able to go to space. And so in 2009, there were many years of work that culminated in the launching of the very first space telescope that was devoted entirely to the study of extrasolar planets. It's called the Kepler telescope. And when it was launched, it was launched not into a low Earth orbit like the Hubble Space Telescope. It was deployed to one of the Lagrangian points of the Earth, which are the regions around, the places around the Earth where the gravitational effect of the Sun and the Earth are equal. And it means that you can have stable orbits at those locations. This is in an Earth trailing orbit, which means it follows the Earth around the Sun. And what it was designed to do was to stare at a particular field of the sky, which contains about 170,000 stars. So by looking at 170,000 stars for many years, then the idea is that it should see some of those transit. And in particular, if it looks for about 4 years, then if it were something like the Earth, which takes a year to go around the Sun, then you would see four transits, something like that. And so the idea of the mission was to discover planets like the Earth around other stars. Well, I'll tell you in a moment how many it's discovered, but first let's look at a histogram showing the discovery rate of exoplanets. Now, what's shown here is on the horizontal axis, we have the year of discovery. On the vertical axis, this is our histogram axis showing the number of detections. And I've broken it down by detection method. And the two methods I've been talking to you about have been the radial velocity method, which is shown in red, and the transit method, which is shown in green. And as time goes on, you can see that there were very few discoveries made in the early days. Back in 1995, there was a discovery of 51 Pegasi, which was discovered by a group of Swiss astronomers and confirmed by astronomers at San Francisco State. And then what came after that, this was the period I was doing my PhD here, it was very exciting because there were new planet discoveries going on, but just a handful every year. And so each one was very, very, very exciting. And once we move over to this area, you can see that the green, which is the transit method, starts to become dominant. And there's a reason for that. We have some ground-based transit surveys over here, but then when Kepler is launched, you can see that the green starts to dominate. And in fact, in around about 2010 was the first year that the transit method discovered more planets than the reigning champion of planet discovery at that time, which was the radial velocity method. But you can also see that there it reaches some peak here and then drops, which is kind of weird because what happened? Did we run out of planets? Well, what happened was, it was a couple things. One is that Kepler gave us so much data that we were completely unprepared as a community. And there was so much, because compared to drinking from a fire hose, right? We were unable to cope with that amount of data. And so it took us some time to understand the data, how to study it properly, and how to get the planets from it. But the other thing is that many of the folks who had been using the radial velocity method to discover planets started using their method to follow up the Kepler planets. That means that the radial velocity method was no longer so much discovering planets as it was confirming the ones discovered by Kepler. But you'll also notice that this is quite a few years out of date. In fact, 2013 was the year that I moved to San Francisco State from the NASA Exoplanet Science Institute. So this has some updating. So let's update it. This is now what it looks like if we add the four intervening years. And these large green spikes here will probably come as a surprise to absolutely nobody that they are due to Kepler. More results from Kepler. Understanding the data that was in that fire hose finally happened, and we were able to confirm many of the planets that we were previously unable to do so. So these years were real booms in the planet discovery rate from Kepler. Now, as I mentioned, the idea of the Kepler mission was to answer a fundamental question, which is, are Earth-sized planets common? Because the early discoveries were largely concerned with planets which were very large, like Jupiter, or even larger. And that's because those kinds of planets are very, they're the easiest to discover. And so those are the low-hanging fruit that you tend to find first. But what we really wanted to know was, are there many Earth-sized planets out there? We're already starting to get an idea of how many Jupiter planets there might be out there. But what about the Earth-sized planets? This is an important question to answer because it was going to justify the funding or lack thereof for future missions. Because if there were a few Earth-like planets out there, then that's a very sad state of affairs. But if there are many out there, then that's excellent justification for going further and doing more work. Well, so before I quantify the answer to that question, here is a plot which attempts to summarize many of the results from Kepler. And this is a plot which has the size of the planet relative to the Earth on the vertical axis. And on the horizontal axis, we have the orbital period in days. And so it shows Earth, which is over here at 1 and 365 is around about here. But there's something that you'll notice from this distribution of planets, which is that if we look at the top left are the largest planets at the shortest orbital periods, right? And I just told you that those ones are the easiest to detect because they're the low-hanging fruit. However, you notice that as you head down in a diagonal direction towards the bottom right corner, you'll notice that the density of points is increasing. So it's increasing away from where we're most sensitive. And so this is an important part of what Kepler taught us. And what Kepler taught us was this. If you imagine a pile of rubble, like at a mining site or something like that, then you'd expect in that pile of rubble to find a couple large boulders. Then, as you go down in size, you'd expect to find many more of the large rocks. And then many, many more of the smaller rocks. And then many more of the pebbles. By the time you get to the grain of sand, you can no longer count it. And it turns out that planet formation works in exactly the same way, which is that you find many, many more of the smaller planets than you do of the larger planets when you look at a planetary system. And so what Kepler has taught us is that planet frequency increases towards smaller radii. And this is great. This is good news. Not only are they common, they are some of the most common types of planets in the universe are the smaller planets. And in fact, it's the larger planets, like Jupiter, which are kind of not as common as you might think. And this is, and just as an aside there, I'll mention that one thing to keep in mind during this whole presentation is this whole anthropic view of the universe. It's very interesting to me because I've lived on either side of this exoplanet discovery boom when before then all we knew about was the solar system. And so we based all of our ideas on the frequency of planets, how they form, what are they like, everything based on the solar system. And now we know that our solar system in many ways is the exception and that planets like Jupiter are not so common. But the broader perspective is thinking about trying to get out of this anthropic viewpoint of this is what our solar system is like, therefore it's what other solar systems must be like, which isn't true. But also about habitability, of course. What makes our planet habitable may not be what makes other planets habitable. And we need to be very careful about that discussion. So the number of exoplanets is a number which changes almost daily, at least weekly. And where I used to work at the NASA Exoplanet Science Institute, they have a site which I used to work on called the NASA Exoplanet Archive, where they have a charter to update that at least once a week. They must keep it up to date. So it's very, very reliable. If they don't have it up to date, then they get smacked from NASA headquarters or something happens. So it is very up to date, and I checked it this morning, and the number was at about 3,475. It may be out of date already, I don't know. They may have updated it while I'm giving this talk. But there's also a large number of what you see I've called Kepler candidates, about 4,500 Kepler candidates. Those are the objects discovered by Kepler to transit, but we haven't confirmed that they're planets yet. It could be something else. It could be some stellar activity or some binary star or something else which manifests itself as a transit and it requires confirmation. However, I can tell you that about 90% of the candidates turn out to be real, which means that we have approximately about 8,000 planets that we have under our belt. Not bad for a couple of decades' work as a civilization, I would say. So the main result, as I said from Kepler, is that the planet frequency increases to smaller sizes, and of course this gives us a lot more work to do because now we can go back to those other areas of characterization and habitability. So in my work, as I mentioned, there's three broad areas that I work in, but just to go through them once again before I move on to habitability, the step one is the planet hunting part. That's something that I'm still heavily involved in. I'm using radial velocities, transits, I still moonlight in the microlensing method, and I'm now using imaging as well. So I think I've covered most of the bases there. And then I'm very interested in studying planetary orbits. I do dynamical simulations of orbits and see which our orbital configurations can be stable, which is another exciting area that we can study with planetary systems, as well as, of course, studying their atmospheres. And it is still amazing to me that we live at a time where we can actually say we are detecting atmospheres around other planets. It's incredible. So the third part is habitable zones. Now, habitable zones is something I need to spend a little bit of time explaining, because the term habitable zone is very, very confusing. And as a result, it has fallen into some disrepute over recent years, at least in the scientific community. Many of you have probably heard the term before, perhaps in the context of a press release or something like that. But it implies the zone in which things are habitable, but that's not what it means. Counterintuitively, that's not what it means. I'll tell you what it means. It's all about the search for water. And there are many things that we could think about, as I said earlier, about what makes our planet habitable. But one thing that we could all agree on is that everything on Earth that is alive requires water. And there are some organisms which can hibernate, go to metabolic slowdown, and not require water for 100 years. But after that, they shrivel up and dehydrate and die, which means they need water. So everything needs water eventually. And but it's not just that. I mean, some people have said about water, well, everything, everywhere you find water, you find life. But, of course, that's not completely satisfactory, because the Earth has been contaminated by life for about 4 billion years. At this stage, the life has burrowed deep into the Earth's crust. I mean, wherever you find anything on Earth, you find life, which is, of course, why we need to spend so much effort decontaminating the spacecraft that we send to Mars looking for searches of life, so that they don't accidentally detect themselves with something that they brought with them. It's also why we crashed the Galileo spacecraft into Jupiter so that it wouldn't crash on Europa, because we couldn't guarantee that it didn't have a hitchhiker on board. And it's also why the Cassini spacecraft in September, I believe, is going to be crashed similarly into Saturn, because we don't want to risk it crashing into Enceladus, where there could be life, and we cannot guarantee that it doesn't have life already on it that it brought with it. And that's because life is just everywhere on Earth. So, having said that, water has been critically important for life on the Earth, and it is a very common hydrogen compound, and it is a natural solvent in which biochemical reactions can take place, and it is a liquid form at a really nice temperature where you expect chemical reactions to occur at a reasonable pace. So water is a good place to start looking. And once again, remember, anthropic. We're being anthropic about this, but we have to start somewhere, and liquid water gives us a starting point. And I'll get to why that's important later on. So, as I said, the definition of the habitable zone is not the zone in which things are habitable. The habitable zone is defined as the region around a star where you could have liquid water on the surface of the planet if it has sufficient atmospheric pressure. So there's a could and an if, and it's important to remember those, because it doesn't guarantee life. It certainly doesn't guarantee intelligent life. And so when you see hyperbole in press releases, you've probably facepalmed a couple of times when you've heard what people have said. Some people said, I'm packing my bags, I'm going there. So it's something that we need to be cautious of, because we're not there yet. But it's a target selection tool. So a planet in the habitable zone does not mean habitable planet. It means that it's a good place to start looking. Now, fairly recently, from last year, one of the things I do is I chair the Kepler Habitable Zone Working Group. And so these are the people who are the gatekeepers for the results coming from the Kepler mission to decide what is a habitable planet and what is, or at least what's a planet in the habitable zone. See, I fell into my own trap. So we published last year a catalogue of planetary candidates which fall in the habitable zone of their stars. And we found some interesting things. Not only did we list out which of the planets fall in their habitable zone, which of the ones are of the right size, meaning that they're small enough to be terrestrial, but when we produced a histogram of the number of planet candidates at a certain radius, then we found that the distribution for those planets which are in the habitable zone is the same as the distribution outside of the habitable zone, within statistical limits. So that means that when we look at the size distribution of planets outside of the habitable zone, that's actually representative of what we can expect to find of planets in the habitable zone. And so at least in this region, this is really good news because it allows us to sample the habitable zone without actually going there. And so the results from the paper are represented in this diagram. So I'm going to spend a few moments on this plot just explaining what this means, because this has got a lot of stuff going on in it. Now, on the horizontal axis here, it looks like I have distance that the planet is from the star, but it's not. In fact, it's the amount of radiation or the amount of flux that the planet receives as a percentage where the Earth is 100%. In fact, if we look at 100% and we go up here, we can see the Earth. And so if something is receiving 200%, it means it's receiving twice the amount of flux that the Earth would normally receive. Now, on the vertical axis, I've got something rather unexpected because those are the temperatures of the host star. And it would be unsurprising, I'm sure, that the extent of the habitable zone where you are looking for essentially where things are the right temperature, that will depend on how hot the star is that they're orbiting. And so we find that these small stars down here, which are the most common kinds of stars in the universe, M dwarfs, those are quite different from these very hot stars up here. And our sun falls around about here, which is why the Earth falls along that line. So these lines here are the boundaries of the habitable zone. And so everything within that region, if it has the right atmospheric pressure and it has water present, then that could be in a liquid state on the surface. So this is exciting because, as I said, it gives us a place to start looking. And this is something that with our one data point of a planet which fulfills this criteria, which is, of course, the Earth, we've fit an amazing curve through and come up with this relationship. But where Venus is obviously interior to the habitable zone for our solar system and has long since lost its liquid water. So one of the things to notice is that we've got planets here which are a variety of sizes. And all of these planets here, I can tell you, are 2 Earth radii or less, because those are our cases where they're probably terrestrial. Anything larger than that, then they're probably a gas giant. And I'll talk more about that in a moment. But when we look at something like this, it's hard to look at something and say, that's Earth-like, which is another common phrase that you hear in the media. However, we can look at something like this and imagine what it might look like, but of course we have no idea. All we have seen is that planet block out some of the light from its star. We haven't seen any surface features. We don't know what's going on at the surface, but these are the targets which will be observed in years ahead. And this is where I keep saying that about looking to the future, but this is all going to culminate in what we're going to be doing in the future. But these planets, as I told you, are less than 2 Earth radii. And if you don't look at that and think that looks a little bit strange, then you haven't been staring at enough placemats lately from the National Air and Space Museum. Because when you look at that, you'd notice that, wait, something looks off there, and you'd be right. And I'll tell you why. Here's the Earth. The Earth is the largest terrestrial body in our solar system. There is no other, no larger terrestrial body that we know of, pending Planet Nine or whatever's beyond the Kuiper Belt, in the solar system. In order to get to the next largest planet, does anybody know which is the next largest planet?
Uranus.
Close. Very, so it's not Uranus. Neptune. The next largest is Neptune. Neptune and Uranus are around about the same size, so either is. But there's a factor of four difference in size. So Neptune is about 3.8 Earth radii. And so there's this huge gap in between. And see, this is one of the anthropic things about our solar system. It made it nice for us when we were learning about the solar system, because it allowed us to categorize things. These are terrestrial planets. These are giant planets. Those are the two kinds of planets that you get. But all of us as scientists know that the universe doesn't give us step functions. It gives us distributions. That's what it gives us. And so there's something missing in our solar system. And in order to verify that, all we needed to do was look at the results of Kepler. Because when we look at the distribution of radii of planets which are out there, then we find that here's Jupiter at about 11.2 Earth radii. Then we go down here to Neptune, which is about 3.8 Earth radii. Earth is down here, but you'll notice that in between them there's a smooth distribution. And that's what we have found. In between Earth and Neptune, there is a smooth distribution of these objects, where some of them are ambiguous as to whether they are terrestrial or whether they are gas giants. Because at some point something will stop being terrestrial and start being a gas giant, and we don't fully understand what that means. It may be as silly a question as asking when does something stop being a cat and start being a dog. We're not really quite sure yet. But there seems to be some smooth distribution there, and we are missing it. It could be that in our solar system that we could have had what we call a super Earth between the orbit of Mars and Jupiter, but the resonances due to Jupiter's orbit prevented any planet formation from ever occurring there. And so we may have missed that opportunity because of the fact that we have a Jupiter, which, remember I said earlier, turned out to be not quite as common as you might think. So it's an interesting feature of our solar system that we are missing these two Earth radii planets, which could be some of the best places to look for life. We don't quite know yet. But I'll show you a couple of examples of what we have found. First of all, one of the most exciting results to come from Kepler was this system, Kepler-186. And Kepler-186 is a very unromantic name. It sounds like the license plate on a car. But what it means is it's the 186th system discovered by the Kepler mission. And this system was quite interesting because it had a planet in the Habitable Zone, which is depicted here, and it's only 10% larger than the Earth, which is something that, according to our models of how much of an atmosphere should be accumulated by a planet of a given mass, is almost certainly terrestrial. And this is the kind of system that made the folks at NASA very, very excited, because they could issue what NASA loves to do, a press release. And they have some very talented people who make movies. And so here we are, in a spaceship flying through the Kepler-186 system, using complete made-up footage. And we're going to fly past these inner planets, which you can see are featureless because they're not in the Habitable Zone. We don't really care about those anyway. But the planet F, which is the fifth planet in the system, is at the outer edge of the Habitable Zone, and so you can see here that there is some speculation about there might be giant polar caps on this planet and may have some liquid water. We don't really know, but this planetary system has had many publications written about it, about the potential habitability, and is one of the first best cases that were found for a planet which is similar to our Earth. Similar in size and similar in the amount of flux that is received from the host star. But you see, that last part, the host star, is where things start to fall apart, because the star itself is one of those stars that I mentioned earlier on called M-dwarfs. The very low mass, low temperature stars. And M-dwarfs are, like I mentioned, the most common kind of star in the universe. There's many of them. Turns out that star formation follows the same size distribution as planet formation. And there's many, many of these M stars out there. And so it's not surprising that we find a lot of planets around these M stars. However, M stars are very different from our Sun in a number of ways. They're very active, and they tend to have a lot of flares, which means that these planets will receive a lot more ultraviolet radiation from the flares that occur on these stars than we receive from the Sun. And so there are a whole range of topics about habitability of planets around M-dwarfs that people are thinking about. Is this really a feasible scenario? Because that's where we're finding a lot of these planets, around these M-dwarfs. So something to keep in mind when we be very cavalier about calling something an Earth twin, or an Earth 2.0, or whatever that means. But that's what we found this planet around, an M-dwarf. But that star is 500 light years away. And 500 light years in galactic terms is pretty close. But it's something that tends to quell a little bit of the emotional outburst that happens when people get all excited about these discoveries. So let's look at something slightly closer, and this is a very recent one. This is the discovery of a planetary system orbiting a star which is being called TRAPPIST-1. TRAPPIST-1, like many of these stars, is named after the Discovery mission which discovered the planets orbiting it. The name of the telescope was TRAPPIST. This is the first system, and what an amazing system it is, because there are seven planets that we know of that are orbiting this star, all of them transiting in perfect harmony, such that when it was observed with the Spitzer Space Telescope, we saw many, many transits of all of them, except for the outermost planet, which is a longer orbital period and was observed with the Kepler telescope. And the star that they're orbiting is once again a very low mass star. In fact, this star is only around about 80 times the mass of Jupiter, which means that if it was any less massive, it would not be able to burn hydrogen in its core, and it would not be on the main sequence. We wouldn't be calling it a star, we'd be calling it something else, like a brown dwarf, one of these other substellar objects. And so this is at the very, very limit of what you would call a star, but it has this remarkable system, and the amazing thing about it is that all of the planets are around about the size of the Earth, which got people very, very excited about it. I'll talk more about that in a moment. But in fact, this planetary system has three planets, maybe four, which are in the habitable zone of that system. This system is 40 light years away. And so it's still a little bit far away. So let's go a little bit closer. So go a bit closer. In fact, we are going to go to what is by definition the closest exoplanet. And that is the planet orbiting Proxima Centauri. So Proxima Centauri, which, interesting history with Proxima Centauri, which I won't go into. Of Of course, Proxima Centauri is not visible to the naked eye, so you can't go out and see the star, even though it's a mere 4 and a bit light years away. So it wasn't known until the use of the telescope on the sky. But Proxima Centauri is now known to have a planet orbiting it, and that planet has about the mass of the Earth, give or take. And, once again, it's in the habitable zone. Now, this was really the discovery that made a lot of people, including a lot of my colleagues, by the way, say, let's pack our bags and go, as though the discovery came with new physics. And if you calculated, I don't know if it's a fun little back of the envelope calculation to do, by the way. If you look at, for example, the speed of one of the fastest spacecraft we have, which is New Horizons, because that only took 10 years to travel the 5 light hours to Pluto, and then you can convert the 4.24 light years to Proxima Centauri into light hours and do that math, and you come out with 75,000 years. So that's how long it would take to get there if we travel at the speed of New Horizons. Clearly we need new physics in order to be able to actually go there. But this has been very, very exciting discovery. Now I want to tell you about a couple of the problems of these planets which are in the Habitable Zone, because the key thing is to remember that we only know the mass and or the radius, because that's what we measure. We know the distance it is from the star. We know how much energy it receives. We know that the star is, in most cases, very different from the Sun. In all three of these cases, Kepler-186, TRAPPIST-1, and Proxima Centauri, they've all been M dwarfs, which are all very different from the Sun. So there could be some complications. And one of the things that we have to recognize is that within our own solar system, we have two examples of an Earth-sized planet, right? So we have the Earth and we have Venus. So Venus is about 95% the size of the Earth. And that 5% difference is not something that we would be able to measure from what we're measuring with Kepler or any other method at the moment. So we would not be able to tell the difference, at least in terms of size, between something like Venus and something which is the size of the Earth. Now, I presume many of you are familiar with Venus, but to just bring home the point of why this is a problem, this is a picture of Venus from the surface, from one of the Venera spacecraft. So the surface temperature there is about 850 degrees Fahrenheit, and it has 90 times the Earth's atmospheric pressure and sulfuric acid in the atmosphere. So if you were to go to Venus, you would be melted, crushed, and dissolved all at the same time. And it has frequent lightning storms, which means you'd also be electrocuted. But this is a problem, that we have in our sample a whole lot of planets which are probably very dissimilar from the Earth. One thing that, remember, the question that we answered earlier on with Kepler was, how common are planets of Earth size? And we've answered that. We haven't answered the question, how common are planets like the Earth? We have not answered that. To do that, we need to look at the atmospheres. And this is where the field is going right now. So at this point, we've reached this barrier of understanding the surface conditions of these planets. And the key to unlocking what's going on at the surface is the atmosphere. The atmosphere is the thing that we can measure. As I mentioned very earlier on, that we are already starting to do this, measure the atmosphere for planets, but it's mostly giant planets which are transiting. What does it take to even measure an atmosphere? Well, we can use this very clever technique called transmission spectroscopy. Transmission spectroscopy involves the following. We look at the star many, many times, and we take a spectrum of the star to the point where we understand the star very, very well. We understand all of the absorption features and the chemical abundances which make up the spectrum of that star. Then what happens is we wait for the planet to pass in between us and the star. And what will happen during that transit is that the light from the star will pass through the limb of the planetary atmosphere on its way to us. And in the process, several more absorption lines or absorption features will appear due to the abundances in the planetary atmosphere that are separate from those which are occurring due to the intrinsic abundances of the star itself. So through this process, we can actually get a spectrum of a planet that is around another star. Now, this is not an easy thing to do. It's what we would call a very low signal-to-noise kind of a thing that we're trying to do here. And often it requires that we measure this during many transits. So we have to observe it during one transit, then another transit, build our data up until we are actually convinced in the absorption features that we're seeing in the spectrum. But this is what we can do. And this is what really we're going to need to do in order to answer this question of how many of these planets that I've shown you throughout this talk, the TRAPPIST-1 planets, the Proxima planet, Kepler-186, all the ones which were in that catalog paper that we published, how many of those are the Dr. Jekyll of the Earth or the Mr. Hyde of Venus? And as I said, the key to that is the absorption lines in the spectrum of the atmosphere when we'll be able to correctly model what is going on at the surface. Now, there is a way forward here in order to be able to do this, and this is coming very soon. And over the next couple of years, we're going to see some very exciting exoplanet missions that are going to help us to do this kind of work. Now, one of these, before I mention the missions that are coming up, there's one other part I forgot to mention, which is another part of my research. Ah, got to talk more about my own research. So one of the other projects that I'm working on is volcanism on exoplanets. Now, when I'm talking about surface features of or surface conditions of exoplanets, and we're usually talking about the temperature which is occurring at the surface, one of the things that I'm doing in a very multidisciplinary kind of way, because this has become a very multidisciplinary subject, there are a lot of things about the earth sciences that I don't know about, and so I go to my colleagues who study this, volcanologists, and ask them about what signatures I would expect to see in an atmosphere of a planet that had a substantial amount of volcanic activity. And so a volcano like this one from Chile from a couple of years ago is producing enough volcanic emission like sulfur dioxide that it pushes it up into the stratosphere and is sustained for a long enough period of time that you'll actually see it during the transmission spectroscopy. And so this is not only telling us about the surface conditions of the planets, but also about the geological processes which are going on, which is where I really need my earth sciences colleagues to come on board with this work that I'm doing. So in the end, what we're going to be trying to do is look for signatures that will be evidence of habitability. Those are sometimes referred to as biosignatures, signatures of biological activity. And one of the key processes that we as a community are going through at the moment is trying to discern what kinds of processes would end up being false alarms for us. Because we tend to think of oxygen as a molecular composition in our atmosphere that we rely on very heavily and is produced, at least in our case, by photosynthesis. But it's not necessary to have biological processes in order to have that in your atmosphere, and there are geological processes which can also produce oxygen. Now, if you have a case of disequilibrium, meaning you have molecular oxygen in the presence of something like methane, which react very heavily with each other, and if you have those in the same location for too long, then quickly you'll end up with carbon dioxide and water vapor. But if you, in order to have that methane present, then you need to have something producing it, like cows farting or something like that. It's something biological going on at the surface which may be produced in this source of disequilibrium. Those are the things that we're trying to understand as biosignatures. This is, of course, yet another one of those things which we tend to be anthropic about. We look at something like this and know what the features are that work for us. Some people have said that I don't know what I'm looking for when it comes to biosignatures in life, but I'll know it when I see it. My great fear is that's absolutely not true, that we will not know it when we see it, that there will be sources of biological activity that will manifest in the atmosphere and we won't recognize it. So this is going to be a process of understanding these possible combinations of signatures. Right, now, on to what I was going to say a few moments ago about what's coming up in the next couple of years. First of all, in April of next year, there is going to be another dedicated exoplanet mission, and it's called the Transiting Exoplanet Survey Satellite. I'm very proud to be part of the process of this mission. I'm on the Target Selection Working Group, and we're working very hard at the moment trying to map out the stars of the sky that TESS is going to look at. Because unlike Kepler, which stared at a particular patch of 170,000 stars, TESS is going to be looking at the entire sky. And it's going to be doing this with wide-field cameras, which, as is shown here, it's going to tile the sky, and it's going to gradually move around, and in this process, it's going to do the northern hemisphere, and then it's going to turn around and do the southern hemisphere. In fact, it's going to start with the southern hemisphere and do the other way around. But it's going to map the whole sky, and it's going to be able to detect transiting planets around the brightest stars. Now, the reason that's significant is because, remember, I mentioned that getting these transmission spectra from planetary atmospheres is a very low signal-to-noise experiment. Very low signal-to-noise. So what we need is bright stars. We need to boost the number of photons that we're receiving somehow. And so we're going to solve this with TESS. It's launching April next year. It was going to be earlier, but TESS is going to be launched by our friends from SpaceX on a Falcon 9. And one of those catastrophically and spectacularly exploded on the launch pad not so long ago. There's been a delay in the launch because they wanted to properly diagnose that. We're very happy for them to diagnose it as much as they want and tell us when they're ready. There's nothing quite as devastating as having your years of work and payload blow up on the launch pad. But TESS is going to be launched in April, and it's going to continue for a few years, tiling the entire sky, discovering many hundreds of transiting exoplanets around the brightest stars. Now, the partner, I'm going to offend a lot of my astronomy colleagues by calling the James Webb Space Telescope a partner to TESS. James Webb Space Telescope is not an exoplanet mission. I only wish that it was. But what's going to happen with the James Webb Space Telescope is that it is going to follow up on the discoveries of TESS to do the transmission spectroscopy of their atmospheres. The James Webb, for those of you who don't know, is not going to be in a low Earth orbit like the Hubble either. It is also going to be deployed to a Lagrangian point, a different Lagrangian point from Kepler, but it means that it'll be well away from the Earth and it will be able to continuously observe some of the sky. And this is actually, if you haven't seen this, this is an animation which is showing how the James Webb is going to unfold when it once it reaches the Lagrangian point. I'm not an engineer, I don't pretend to be. Things like this just scare the hell out of me because all I do is I count the points of failure. And I think, oh my God, just please, please don't anything get stuck. But I'm sure it'll be fine. And and James Webb is still scheduled to be launched at the end of 2018. So by the time TESS is returning a lot of these transiting planets around bright stars, it will be just in time to follow them up with the James Webb Space Telescope. And we'll be able to do a lot more of this work and finally understand which of these planets that we're finding are more like the Earth or more like something else. Because I think the key message at the end of the day, at the end of all of this, is that, like I said earlier on, the universe doesn't give us categories, it gives us distributions. And I've been talking about Earth and Venus, but those are only two examples of what I expect to be a continuum of planetary atmospheres. We'll find something which is like Venus or a little bit different from Venus, somewhere between Venus and Earth, and 100 different kinds of atmospheres in between. And so that's what we can look forward to in the next couple of years when we look at all of these different kinds of planets that have been discovered by Kepler and soon to be discovered by TESS. What this will translate to is in more of these scatter kind of plots, except now we'll be talking about atmospheric abundances and the possibilities for life on the surface. So I'll finish there, and thank you everyone for your attention, and I'll take any questions. Right, so for most of the sky, for each of those tiles that you saw in that animation, TESS will be observing for about 30 days. And one of the reasons for that, actually, is because TESS, unlike Kepler, will be in an Earth orbit. Not a low Earth orbit, it's kind of this weird elliptical orbit in resonance with the moon, so they don't crash into each other, which is nice. It does mean that since it's anchored to the Earth, that it just follows around in right ascension when it's choosing these tiles, which means that it moves to a new hour angle every 30 days. And so there is an issue there that means that, in principle, that means you're only discovering planets that have an orbital period up to 30 days, assuming that you need at least one transit. But after it completes the northern hemisphere, the southern hemisphere, northern hemisphere, in extended mission, it will go back to the southern hemisphere. And the other part is that, I don't know if you could tell, but near the poles, there are a bunch of fields that overlap. And in those fields, we'll have a lot more data, and so we'll be sensitive to planets which have much longer orbital periods.
I had a question about tidally locked planets. That's a class. I kind of think about, what are the classes of planets that we haven't seen in our own solar system? First it was hot Jupiters, we have super Earths, and now we're saying some of these things, the M dwarfs, they have tidally locked planets. How would you summarize the current state of the thinking of what that means for habitability?
Yeah, so one of the side effects I hadn't mentioned about a planet being in orbit around a M dwarf star, which is in the Habitable Zone. The Habitable Zone is a lot closer to the star. You may have seen in some of those pictures that some of these systems can actually fit inside the orbit of Mercury, and so they're very, very close to their stars. And the side effect of that is that means that we expect that a lot of these planets are tidally locked, so the same sign is always facing the star. The effect that has on habitability, it is going backwards and forwards in the literature at a wild rate. There are some papers which even suggest that it enhances habitability, but a lot of it seems to depend on atmospheric circulation. So if the energy being received at the day side of the planet is being redistributed to the night side through atmospheric dynamics, then that's fine. But there have even been other. In fact, one of the TRAPPIST planets, I saw suggestions about there would be a liquid water regime at the terminator of the planet, where you'd have this thin region of habitability. I'm not sure how sustainable that is, but I think the jury's still out on that topic.
So we're going to have much more time for questions to 5:15. I know that some of our students need to leave right at 5. I'm going to ask you to leave quickly and quietly in the next minute, and the rest of us will continue. There's going to be a lively discussion and question sessions. Please exit quickly and quietly. Namaste. We want to get right back to discussion, so we're going to take this outside. I will do that in a moment.
So those are very important questions. So for the first question about my recent paper about TRAPPIST-1 and compact systems in general not being able to have moons, and the reason for that is pretty straightforward, actually. It's simply that the Hill radius, or the gravitational influence of the planets, scales linearly with the distance of the planet from the star. So if you look at these compact systems very close to their star, they lose a lot of the influence that they would normally have, whether that matters for habitability. In the introduction to the paper, I did a review of the literature, which speaks about the effect that the moon has had on the Earth's habitability in the context of stabilization of the obliquity, and. It's an interesting discussion when you look at it. Over the last few decades, that is another one of these arguments which has gone backwards and forwards, because there were original papers which suggested that the obliquity of the Earth would vary wildly without the moon, the angular momentum effect of the moon. But then there was there have been more recent papers which say, well, you know, it would vary, but not as bad as you think it might. So that part, I don't think that's a deal breaker, not having a moon, certainly. Now, the other argument about moons is that, well, the moon may have not necessarily been necessary for life on Earth, but certainly catalyzed it by providing more tidal pool effects. That also may be true, but it's another thing which I wouldn't consider a deal breaker. So it's one of those things that if it doesn't have moons, it's really hard to say, because the only instance we know of life, we have a moon. So it's one of these cases where you try not to be too anthropic about it. Your other question about magnetic fields is a very, very difficult one, because the M stars, like I said, are very active. They have these large flare events, which are high energy and therefore ultraviolet rich radiation, which can be very dangerous for stripping atmospheres. And so there have been a few papers which have come out in the wake of TRAPPIST-1, and with Proxima Cend, there were people who thought about this as well. People who were like raining on the habitability parade, of which I was one, saying, well, this is all nice, but those planets probably would have lost their atmospheres because of all the UV emission. Whether they have magnetic fields is obviously a key part of that. And I spoke recently at an astrobiology meeting where I was talking about what's coming up in the years ahead in what we're going to be able to unlock in terms of planetary parameters, in being able to measure them. We want to be able to measure because I've spoken about mass, radius, atmosphere. There are obviously many things beyond that. The rotation rate of the planet, whether it's tidally locked. The obliquity of the planet, which may or may not depend on whether it has a moon as to whether that's varied a lot. Believe it or not, the rotation and the obliquity are things we will be able to measure in about 10 years from imaging missions. However, when it comes to magnetic fields, that's extremely difficult, because trying to detect the magnetic field of an exoplanet, if it's something like Jupiter that has a huge magnetic field, then you could detect at radio wavelengths, but probably not for a terrestrial planet at such large distances. But the only, one of the only other alternatives is if there's any star-planet interactions. Often we look for signs that the magnetic field of the planet is interacting with the star, perhaps by inducing spot activities or some other effect. And that is also extremely difficult to do, hasn't really been done a lot of times. I don't have a lot of hope, unfortunately, for detecting the magnetic field of the planet, which is a shame because it is extremely important.
There's a question in my mind about the distinction between Earth-like planet and terrestrial planet, and then there's this two diameters limitation on those at the beginning. You were saying if it gets bigger than twice the size of the Earth, it's not one of those. Where does that come from?
Right. So what we have been able to do for many of the Kepler, because it's mostly been the Kepler mission that has provided us with the Earth-sized planets that we now know about. And for those planets, what we get from Kepler is a radius. Now, if we are able to measure a mass as well, then we get a mean density. And then we can start to see where this transition between terrestrial and gas giant may occur, because for the terrestrial planets of our solar system, we're mostly about 5 grams per cubic centimeter. Once we move out to the giant planets, it drops to like 1.5, or in the case of Saturn, less than 1. And so we should be able to see that transition. At the moment, the data is very difficult to determine where that transition occurs, but there have been several papers, very good papers, one particular by Leslie Rogers, which addressed this. And suggested that boundary is actually around about 1.6. In fact, she was suggesting that some of the 1.6 radii planets may not be terrestrial. But when we do look at what we currently have, if you make a plot of mean density versus radius, then you can see where a transition occurs. This is something that TESS will be able to help us enormously with, and in fact, a lot of the science motivation for TESS is to produce a really robust mass-radius relationship for planets, which will tell us more about where this transition occurs. But another feature of this kind of study, if you like, is that it's obviously going to be very composition-dependent. Two different planets will have different mass and radius relationships with different compositions. It'll just change things entirely. But at the moment, the community tends to hover around two Earth radii as that transition. Things less than that within the uncertainties, we'll call those terrestrial. Things larger than that, we'll call them mini Neptunes or gas giantish. Yes?
Is there any chance we'll be able to know for sure whether we're seeing water worlds in the future? Can you see any observational way to do that?
Oh, that's a really good question. In fact, that's come up several times recently. And in fact, the recent atmospheric detection, which I didn't mention in this talk, for GJ1132b, which is a planet which is, I think it's at least 1.5 times the size of the Earth, but they detect an absorption feature, which they say is consistent with either methane or water vapor. And all water vapor, and so it's and so what they suggest from that is that if it has a very dense amount of water vapor in the atmosphere, then that could mean it's a water world. And in case anyone is wondering, it is essentially the Kevin Costner film if he hadn't run out of money. And, so, but it's, when you think about the water world, one of the things I raised earlier on is that water equals life. That was the kind of logic I was following, which you could extrapolate from that to more water equals more life. But actually, if you have a water world, then there's a lot of folks in the multidisciplinary community who are thinking about this in terms of the erosion effects from continents that you'll no longer have. So you'll no longer have this silicate recycling which occurs on the Earth, and that will actually be a very large impediment to having habitability on those water worlds. So although we tend to think of water worlds as something which is kind of like our ocean sea life on steroids or something like that, it's likely to be actually quite the opposite. But water vapor, it does have these very broad absorption features, and it seems to be one of the very first things that we'll be able to address in terms of being able to see this in other planets. Whether we can unambiguously say that means that there's vast reservoirs of liquid water in order to have that amount of water vapor in the atmosphere, not quite sure yet.
Are we missing detecting planets that orbits aren't just right in our line of sight? I mean, it seems like there would be a whole lot of others.
Yes, that's right. And it's one of the things I didn't mention about the transit method is that there's a probability assumed in that. And of course, this is the same thing with TESS, since TESS is always also using the transit method. In the very early days of when I was working on the transit method in the late 90s and early 2000s, and we were designing these ground-based experiments to look for transiting planets, I always refer to it as a brute force approach, which is that if you randomly orient orbits and you look at something like what we call a hot Jupiter, something the size of Jupiter, which is in a 4 or 5 day orbit, those have about 10% chance of transiting, which is pretty good. That means, in principle, you look at 10 stars, and if every star has one of those, then you'll see one. That was where we first started to get our idea of how common those kinds of planets might be, because we weren't finding nearly as many as we thought we would. But when it comes to Earth-like planets, something like the Earth has about a 0.1%. If we were an alien civilization looking at our solar system from a random angle, then there's a 0.1% chance we'd see the Earth transit. Which means that if we want to look for Earth analogs, then we use the brute force approach, which is look at as many stars as we can. In the case of Kepler, 170,000, which means that if it's 0.1% probability, then we should see 170 Earths, which is actually not too dissimilar from what it found, which is since we know that the frequency rises to those kinds of planets. It means that the transit method is not even remotely getting everything. It is getting us a sample of those planetary systems that just happen to be aligned. And from there, knowing what we know about how the probability of a transit works, we can extrapolate from that to what we should have been seeing.
Well, let's thank Dr. Kane again.